So let's get started. All of classical information can be written down in terms of classical bits. As a result, all of classical computing, communication, and cryptographic systems work with classical bits. As you might imagine, quantum cryptography instead works with quantum bits, or in short, qubits. Qubits are rather different than classical bits. For example, we will see that they cannot be copied. So what precisely are these qubits? Before we start with qubits, let's briefly go back to classical bits. A classical bit is just 0 or 1. But it will be useful to write these classical bits slightly differently. We will associate both of these bits with a vector. For 0, I will pick this vector. And for 1, I'll take this one. These two vectors are orthogonal, so we can think that there is an axis, which I'll call alpha, with the vector 0, and another axis, beta, with the vector 1. So far, so good. We haven't really done anything there. We've just written the bits in another way. So how about these qubits? If I draw these bits as vectors, it is now somehow intuitive that we may not just have orthogonal vectors, but we may also consider a vector in the middle. This funny notation is how people in quantum information like to write vectors. We can, of course, express it in terms of the coordinates alpha and beta. So written in terms of the original classical bits, I can express the vector as alpha times 0 plus beta times 1. We also say that such a qubit can be in a superposition of 0 and 1. So a qubit has a little of the 0 and a little of the 1 bit in it at the same time. You may be wondering if any vector can be a qubit. For example, could this vector also be a qubit? We will make a demand, namely that the length of the qubit vector is still the same as the length of the classical vectors. For classical bits, we have taken vectors which have exactly length 1. So we will demand that our qubit also corresponds to the vectors that have length exactly 1. And if alpha and beta are real numbers, as I've drawn them here, that just means that the square of alpha plus the square of beta equals 1. So this is a qubit. This is a rather mathematical description, but you might be wondering, what do qubits really look like in the real world? What does this mathematical expression model? There are, of course, a lot of possible experimental implementations of qubits. We will actually not be concerned with them in this lecture series, but it's good to have a quick look to get an intuition about what superposition really means. When we consider a maze, and we were to associate 0 with left and 1 with right, then classically I can send a particle either to the left or to the right. However, quantumly, we can do left and right at the same time. This means that the particle would be in a superposition of being on the left and on the right. Another example is a physical implementation in which we represent bits by energy levels in an atom. we can say that the ground state, or the lower one, is called 0, and the higher one is called 1. A classical bit means that my systems will be in one of these two states, so either in the ground state or in the excited state. A qubit can be in a superposition between 0 and 1. That is effectively in the ground and the excited state at the same time. To construct the qubits, we started from the classical bits as vectors, and these vectors have a special name. Namely, we will call them the standard basis, or sometimes also the computational basis. So our qubit looks like this. And the question is, what are these numbers alpha and beta? We will call these numbers amplitudes. And even though I've drawn them on the real number sphere, they can in general be complex numbers. A qubit is thus some element of a complex vector space of dimension 2. Let's see how we can express the demand that our vectors should have length 1. We have this very peculiar way of writing vectors in terms of cats and brass. So this is what we will call a cat. And if I turn it around, it becomes a bra. So what does this mean? We take the vector and we compute its conjugate transpose. The star will be our notation for conjugate. And the big T will be our notation for transpose. Okay, so a bra is nothing else than the short way of writing the conjugate transpose. Let me actually do that. I take the vector, and first I apply the conjugate. Conjugate these complex numbers, and I still have to compute the transpose. So in the end, we have alpha conjugate and beta conjugate. It will be convenient for us to look at the inner product between two vectors. In terms of the vectors, the cat and the bra, giving us the bracket, we can now write this quite simply. We, of course, will be lazy and omit the double middle stripe and just write one. To give an example, this means that if I take the inner product, I'll take the conjugate, transpose, which we've already computed, I'll take the original vector, alpha and beta, and what we'll compute is alpha conjugate times alpha, beta conjugate times beta. And we'll also write this as alpha squared plus beta squared. So the condition that the vectors have length 1 can now be written in terms of the inner product. So what we'll get is that the inner product of the vector with itself has to be 1. So in terms of the alpha and the beta, this means that the sum of alpha squared plus beta squared is 1. So this is a qubit. Let's have a look at an example. I will draw a real example. So my alpha and betas are actually going to be real numbers here. And let's remember that these are the vectors that define the standard basis. The state that I want to consider, the qubit that I want to consider, is the one which is just in the middle between 0 and 1. We often write this state as the ket plus state, which is an equal superposition between 0 and 1. So let's now check that this is a valid qubit. It's obviously a vector, so this is a good start. So what we want to do is we want to check that the length of the vector is 1. So let's do that. So note that I can plug in here the definition of these vectors, 1, 0, plus 0, 1, which gives us 1 over square root 2, 1, 1. So let me compute the inner product of plus with itself. So I have 1 over square root 2, I have this twice. So multiplying these two numbers gives me a half. I have the transpose vector. I have the original one. So let's compute that. We have half times 1 plus 1, which is 1, as promised. Of course, another example of a qubit would be another direction, for example, this one.